Good morning and a really warm welcome to you from Grace Baptist Church in Halifax. It's a pleasure to have you here watching online. Today we have actually two kind of gatherings running at the same time, if you like, because we have been able to begin our gathering at the church building again for those who are able to come. And that will be running today at 10:45 and at 4 o'clock this afternoon as well. But for anyone who's not able yet to make it to those, we're still providing this online service too, so that you can enjoy worshipping God in your own home. And I trust you're able to do that, and in that sense to be spiritually at one with those who will be at the building today. They will certainly be thinking of you, as I know you'll be thinking of them. So I trust you're encouraged as we have fellowship in this kind of virtual way, and as we hear God's word and sing together where we all are in our different homes. I'm very grateful today to our brother Paul Lintott, the pastor at Hall Green Baptist Chapel in Haworth. Because we are going back to the physical gathering at the building today, I've asked if he would lend us one of his messages from the church there in Haworth to provide the message for us today on this online service. So later on he'll be preaching to us from Luke's Gospel, then you'll be able to catch up next week, God willing, with the service that took place today at the church building. So let me truly welcome you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, because it's Him who is the centre of our worship, and He is the one we want to think about today, isn't it? He is the one who takes all the glory, and we love to give it to Him. Let me read to you these words from the book of Hebrews about the Lord Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7 says this: "During the days of Jesus' life on earth, He offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him." Let's pray together, shall we? Gracious Father, our living and righteous God, we worship you this morning from our hearts, thanking you for sending your Son to be our Saviour. We thank you that He came to earth as one of us, that though He was the Son, the eternal Son of God, who never had a beginning and shall never have an end, though He was the second person of the Trinity, though He reigned over all things from all eternity, Lord, we thank you that He came, that He humbled Himself, that He became one of us. And remarkably, He learned obedience through what He suffered, through becoming a man, coming alongside us, learned what it meant to obey as a human being His Heavenly Father, and to suffer alongside us, and then to suffer for us by dying on the cross, bearing our penalty and our shame. Then we thank you, Lord, that He has now been raised from the dead, and He grants eternal salvation to all who will call on Him and obey Him in repentance and faith. So we thank you for Him, and we pray that today would be a day where we meet with Him through your word and by your Spirit, and that we would rejoice together in our great salvation that comes to us through the Lord Jesus Christ. So be with those who are meeting at the church building today, be with everyone who's listening online to this service, and unite us in our hearts together for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to sing now and worship God by reminding ourselves of our great creator God who became one of us. It's the song Creation Sings the Father's Song. So if you're able to join in at home, please do sing along with this.
Calls the sun to wake the dawn and run the course of day till evening falls in crimson rays. His fingerprints and flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning globe. He charts the eagle's flight, commands the newborn baby's cry. Whose blameless life would break the curse, whose death would set us free to live with him eternally. Shall reign upon the earth. The bitter wars, the rage, are birth pains of a coming age. When he renews the land and sky, all heaven will sing and earth reply. With one resplendent theme, the glories of our God and
Now let's read part of God's precious words together. In a moment I'm going to be saying a few words to the young people and children, and this passage has to do with that particularly, but is wonderful for all of us. It's from Isaiah's prophecy and chapter 9, and it's one of those passages which we sometimes read at Christmas time, and in the run-up to Christmas I thought it would be a good one to read. And you'll see even more why when I speak to the children. But this is Isaiah chapter 9 and the first 7 verses. Isaiah 9 and 1 to 7. Let's hear God's word. Nevertheless, There will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honour Galilee of the nations by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Amen. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. We just read that from the book of Isaiah, chapter 9. It's like the whole world was in darkness. They didn't know God, they didn't love God, and their hearts were dark. But then a baby was born. The Lord Jesus Christ. Into the darkness came a light. Let's see if we can get a light on. Yes, there it is. The light of the world. When the Lord Jesus Christ came into the world, it was what the whole world had been waiting for. The world had been in darkness. People didn't know God. But when Jesus was born, the light came on. And people at last could see the truth for themselves if they were looking. Jesus came to tell the truth about God, to speak to us as the one who is God, who loves us, who cares about us, to bring light into our spiritually dark hearts, and anyone who trusts in him will know that light for themselves. But not everyone wanted that light to be in the world. There were some who were afraid when they heard that Jesus had been born. There was a king called Herod who didn't want Jesus to be the king. He wanted to be the king, and so he said, I'm going to get rid of that light. And so Herod tried to get rid of Jesus. But he couldn't. However much he tried, God protected his son. But he wasn't the only one, you see. When Jesus grew up, the devil wanted to get him. The devil wanted to tempt him and make him fall and sin so that he couldn't be our savior anymore. And so the devil tried to put him out. But the devil couldn't. Jesus obeyed his father and loved his father all his life, even when tempted. But then came the great battle at the end. The people rose up and hated him. The religious leaders wanted him dead. And so they put him to death by crucifying him, putting him on a cross. And that was the end of Jesus, they thought. Yes! No. You see,
Jesus rose from the dead 3 days later. And just as it says in the book of John, this is John chapter 1, it says, in Jesus was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Jesus has won. Jesus is the light that could never be put out. And right now, Jesus is still shining. In fact, because everyone who trusts in him joins him in being the light of the world, now the whole world has been made light because of the love of the Lord Jesus. So, will you join him and be the light of the world? Will you trust him and love him and thank him for coming into the world and shining in the darkness? I hope you do. Thanks for listening.
Well, shall we come to God again now in prayer and commit ourselves to him? Let's pray. Gracious Father, we thank you for the light of the world, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we thank you that the light has come into the world and the darkness has not overcome it. We thank you that he rose from the dead and is alive today as our help and our salvation and the hope of the whole world and all the nations can put their trust in him. It's not limited to a group of people or a particular kind of person. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that has been opened wide for all to come to Christ through the gospel. Lord, we pray then, please, would you open the eyes of those who are blind, like I was and like everyone in this church was once. We were all blind. We couldn't see. But then you opened our eyes and caused us to see the glory of Christ and our need of him. And we put our faith in him and repented of our sins because of the power of the Spirit at work in our hearts. Lord, we pray for that miracle of grace to be repeated over and over again in our town, amongst our neighbours and friends and family, and across our world and our nation. We pray for the light of the gospel to spread. Help us to be the light of the world that Jesus has made us and called us to be. Help us, Lord, wherever we have opportunity to say something of him, or to write a note in a Christmas card, or to say something in a phone call, or however it is, Lord, that we say, yes, we're Christians, we have hope, we know Jesus Christ as our Saviour and Lord and want to follow him and share the good news of him with the world. Help us, Lord, to take every opportunity that you give us. And for everything that we seek to do as a church in this very different Christmas period to normal, we pray you'd help us and equip us and those of us who are particularly involved in our outreach at this time, that you'd give us wisdom and the right words to say and the right way of expressing the message of the true meaning of Christmas in Christ in a way that's helpful to people and which shows Christ to them clearly. Lord, as our nation faces the next few weeks and the need for planning about the vaccine for COVID and the need for wisdom over the Christmas period and all that's involved for our national leaders, we pray for them and ask for your help for them, and that we would continue to be able to be good citizens and those who live peaceful and quiet lives, not causing trouble or complaining, but rather thanking you for our leaders and serving our community and our nation in a way that's appropriate to followers of Christ. Lord, for those across the world seeking to spread the light of the gospel, we commit them to you. Thank you for those that we particularly support and those that we know of in different parts of the world and the UK serving you. Give them strength and encouragement at this time, again, which will be very different for so many of them because of different restrictions in different countries due to the pandemic. We pray you'd encourage them and help them. And for every believer loved by you, serving you, whom we don't know personally, we rejoice that there are millions of your people across the world. We pray that you would add to them and that this Christmas period would be a period of rejoicing in heaven as yet others come to faith in the Lord Jesus, who came to earth 2,000 years ago to save us and to make us his own. So Lord, we commit ourselves to you. We pray for your mercy on us, and that the light of the Lord Jesus Christ would shine all the more brightly in our own lives and community and in our world. We pray these things for his glorious sake. Amen. Amen. Well, very soon now we're going to hear from our brother Paul Lintott from Haworth, as I was saying earlier. He is going to be preaching from Luke's Gospel and chapter 22. It's Luke's Gospel, chapter 22, and verses 39 to 46. And there at the church in Haworth, they had one of their members, Trish, read that passage for them. So I thought I'd just leave that in and have a different voice today reading the scriptures. So that will come up soon. But first, we will sing another song and remind ourselves of the presence of the Lord being with us as we approach his word. It's be still, for the presence of the Lord is here with us in this place, whichever place you're in. If you're at home, trust that the Lord would be near to you. So we'll sing, and then we'll have the reading of God's word, and then Paul will preach God's word to us. So let's join in song together.
Verse 39 to 46. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them and knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray so that you will not fall into temptation."
Well, 3 weeks ago, when we were last in Luke 22, I did something slightly unusual and connected the prayer at Gethsemane, which is the passage that Trish has just read, to the previous chapter where Jesus is previous section where Jesus is talking about being ready. And I sort of did a contrast between his call for them to be prepared for what was ahead and then the sleepiness of the disciples at Gethsemane. And that is sort of a side point. It's going on in the Gethsemane incident, but what I want to do this morning, God willing, is look at the main point of Gethsemane, at least some of the main points of Gethsemane. I just ought to start by saying that I think that the Gethsemane incident for me is one of the most profound in the gospel, in the sense that what's going on here, I think, is more complex than just these few verses seem to suggest. I think there are very difficult things going on here that I don't pretend to understand entirely. There's certain relationships that are going on in the prayer. There's a sort of a connection here that's difficult to think through and profound. And I'm all right with that. I'm not worried about that. I think it sort of demonstrates to me that God, in his infinite wisdom, in the gospel, does things that are more wonderful than we understand. Now, in my preparations, not last week, but the week before, as I was getting ready for this Sunday, J.C. Ryle, who was the bishop in London, in Liverpool, sorry, about 140 years ago or so, he's been a great help to me. He wrote a number of very simple and easy to read books on the Gospels, one on Matthew, one on Mark, one on Luke, and one on John. I think they're some of the very best things that J.C. Ryle wrote. I really like the things he wrote. I'm sure Kath will be able to get you some of J.C. Ryle's books if you wanted to read him. I think he's very helpful in lots of ways. But he's been particularly helpful to me as I've been going through Luke again, just looking at how he's approached various bits and pieces that are going on in the Gospel. Some new ideas that I hadn't thought through. Here's two of the things he suggests that come out of this Gethsemane incident, this prayer of Jesus. In his own language, he says, "We see firstly in this passage an example of what believers ought to do in times of trouble." What should we do in times of trouble? Pray. That's what we should do. And then secondly, we see in these verses what kind of prayers a believer ought to make to God in times of trouble. Now, I like that. It's typically J.C. Ryle. Very simple, very straightforward, very practical, and very well applied. And it got me thinking about ways that this prayer in Luke 22, this prayer at Gethsemane, is our prayer. It does belong to us in certain ways. It's an example to us of how we should respond. But there are also ways in which this prayer is not our prayer, most definitely not our prayer. So that's how I thought I'd come at it this morning. Firstly, looking at Jesus as our role model, and then secondly, looking at the ways that Jesus is unique and how only he could make this particular prayer. So firstly then, a prayer for all. It is interesting as you read through the account just how many points of parallel there are here for the disciples and Jesus. Firstly, in verse 39, there's a regular pattern of prayer. I think I mentioned this last time. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. Jesus went out as usual. It's important that we develop this regular pattern of spending time alone with God. That is such an important part of Christianity. I can't remember where the quote comes from, but somebody eminent in the past has said that what we are in private is what we are. Meaning that the time that you spend alone with God is the key part of your religious life. Now, that's not to say that what we do together is not important. Of course it is. But it's on the basis of the time spent in private. Now, that might be a terrifying thought to you because it might reveal that there's a whole lot of noise when we're out in public in terms of, you know, talking about God, talking about the Lord Jesus, praying in public. There may be a lot of that going on, but relative silence and emptiness when we're on our own. If that's so, then what is needed is a reignition of that desire to spend time alone in prayer. So in that way, Jesus challenges me to get real about praying regularly, alone, on my own, making it a habit. Now, all of you have got habits. Some of those probably are not very nice habits, and some of them will be healthy and good habits. Well, here's a habit that Christians need to develop: regular time alone with God. Secondly, notice how he submits in verse 42, and that's a model to us as well. Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. If you are willing. Four simple words, but so complex and difficult in some ways. Firstly, a humble submission from Jesus. He does what the Father tells him to do. He speaks the words that the Father tells him to speak. He does the work that the Father has sent him to do. And that encourages me that in my praying, I need to be humble and let God be God. Whatever path God has chosen for me, there is to be humble submission and readiness to do what he's called me to do. And that's quite difficult because sometimes when we're in prayer, we want to tell God how we want things to be worked out. That's always a temptation, isn't it? And there's nothing wrong with asking God for specific things. I'm not against that. But that needs to be balanced with this humble submission that God is God and he's working out his purposes as he chooses. And that we may not like those purposes being worked out in the way that they're being worked out. But he is the Lord, and I'm not. That's quite a difficult lesson to learn, I think. And it's a perennial lesson. It's one that I have to learn again and again. Because my sort of rebellious heart is always wanting to be king. It's always wanting me to have the final say in what goes on. But even here, the Lord Jesus, if you will, it's submission. Much is made of the interaction here between the Son and the Father, between Jesus and God the Father. And lots of people talk about the two natures of Christ. He is truly human and he is truly God. And some say that what we've got here in this prayer is Jesus' human nature expressing itself, saying, "Not my will, but yours." It's not a contradiction in the Trinity. Of course, they are perfectly in agreement between the three of them, Father, Son, and Spirit. But some would say Jesus, the man here, is recoiling at the horror of crucifixion. Now, that may be true. To be honest, I'm not exactly sure how it works. There are complexities in the Trinity that I think are beyond me at the moment. And I trust that when I get to heaven and I see, then I'll know better than I know now. There are some things that are just beyond me. I'm fine with that. They are one in nature, but three persons distinct. And the love and the unity that they enjoy and have enjoyed from before time is perfection itself. But that doesn't mean that it's all quantifiable and reducible to simple statements and definitions. The Father loves the Son. And the Son loves the Father. And here the Son comes to the Father and struggles with the enormity of what is ahead and humbly submits to what's ahead. And that's a model for me, and I'm happy with that as a challenge to my arrogance and demand for things to be done in my way, as if my agenda is the most important agenda. Thirdly, notice how he asks for help and even receives direct help at that moment. Verse 42, 43, Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me. That's asking for help. Yet not my will, but yours be done. An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. So here's the problem. He lays it out before the Father and he asks specifically for help. And because his praying is so intense and so draining, because he's sweating drops of blood, an angel is dispatched from heaven to help him and strengthen him. Again, a great encouragement to me to cry out for help and not give up praying earnestly when things are difficult. And when things get more difficult, to pray more earnestly and not give up. and also a wonderful encouragement that God's grace is not very far away. I've often been struck how various men and women in the Bible are agonizing in prayer and crying out in the most passionate and intense way. You think about Abraham at various points in his life as he prays over various things, or Daniel, or Hannah. You think about these men and women who trusted God and yet struggled and prayed and cried out. Prayer sometimes is difficult and draining, and yet God does hear and he does send help at the right time. I'm not sure what you're praying for at the moment. I'm sure there are lots of things that are going through your mind at the moment that you're praying for. But here is a challenge and an encouragement. Keep on crying out. Look to heaven for help. It will come in due time. Be patient. Wait. Now, there are probably other parallels here that we could take away, other things that Jesus models for us in this prayer. But there are three of them, and I think they're helpful. They're helpful to me as I've been thinking about that over the last few days. So, in some ways, this prayer is a prayer for many. But secondly, this is a prayer for one. It's the cup, really, that makes that obvious, isn't it? Verse 42, Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. What is the cup? Well, the most reasonable suggestion is that it's a reference back to the book of Isaiah in the Old Testament. Isaiah wrote about 700 years before these events, something like that, 750 years before this. And we've been looking at Isaiah, excuse me, in the evenings. And one of the things that we've seen over the last few months is that God is furious with sin. Now, that's been really unpleasant to see and difficult to hear, but it is true, and it's Isaiah's repeated message in the opening parts of his book. God is furious with sin. He hates sin, and he holds us accountable for sin. When you get to the second half of the book of Isaiah, things change a little, and God spends much more time telling his people how he's going to reverse their situation. In chapter 51, in the middle of a section all about God's rescue plan through his Messiah, he talks about this cup. So remember, first half of Isaiah, God's people and the nations around them under his condemnation, under his wrath. And the second half of Isaiah, this is broad brushstrokes, God's rescue plan through the Messiah. And this is what he says, Isaiah 51. Awake, awake, rise up, Jerusalem, you who have drunk from the hand of the Lord the cup of his wrath, you who have drained it to its dregs, the goblet that makes people stagger. Among all the children she bore, there were none to guide her. Among all the children she reared, there was none to take her by the hand. These double calamities have come upon you. Who can comfort you? Ruin and destruction, famine and sword. Who can console you? Your children have fainted. They lie at every street corner like antelope caught in a net. They're filled with the wrath of the Lord, with the rebuke of your God. Therefore, hear this, you afflicted one, made drunk, not with wine. This is what the Sovereign Lord says, your God who defends his people. See, I have taken out of your hand the cup that made you stagger. From that cup, the goblet of my wrath, you will never drink again. It's a really interesting passage, isn't it, Isaiah 51? You see the metaphor, the picture that's being used there. The judgment that God is bringing on his wayward people is described as a cup, a goblet of wrath. They've had to drink from that cup, metaphorically, for a long time. But God now has promised that he will take it away and his wrath will be poured out elsewhere. So what is Jesus praying in the garden 700 years later? Well, he's asking that the cup of God's righteous wrath might pass from him so that he doesn't have to drink it. Or put another way, rather than absorbing the wrath of God against our sin and wickedness and rebellion, rather than becoming sin for us, he's asking if there's possibly another way for this to happen. What does that mean? Well, it means a whole load of things. Firstly, it means that sin is utterly horrible. Now, my guess is that there are times for all of us when we don't actually believe that, when we think that sin is just a joke, and it doesn't matter how we think or behave or speak or act. I guess for most of us, there are times when it's like that, and we just press on and do what we want to do and say what we want to say. But sin is utterly horrible. And for Jesus to bear the sins of all the people from all time who ever confess and repent of those sins was unimaginably awful. Unimaginably awful. I often think about what it means for Jesus to become sin for me, personally. In my mind's eye, I see him carrying my burden, the weight of my sins, not only the shame, but the awful guilt of them, as if they were his own sins. I say as if, but of course they do become his. That is the very heart of the gospel and the horror and the wonder of it. He takes my sins as his own. He owns them. They become his. It's a horrible thought, isn't it? The thought that Jesus had to carry your worst sin as if he had done it himself, and then to bear the full weight and just wrath of God against that sin. I don't know if you've ever had the experience of being blamed for somebody else's fault or mistake or wrong act. It's very difficult, that, isn't it, when you get blamed for something that somebody else has done. The desire to deny, to pass the blame, to defend yourself is massive. But sometimes in life, you actually have to carry the weight of somebody else's mistake. It does happen. That itself is not unique. That's particularly true in families or in friendships. Sometimes you just have to carry the can for somebody else. That's hard. But here, the weight of guilt is not just one other person. This is millions upon millions of people who have come to the Lord Jesus in repentance and faith and asked him to be their saviour from the beginning to now to right into the future when he returns again. All of those people who have repented, all of that sin, all of that weight on him. What Jesus is accepting here in the prayer is the guilt and shame of what the Bible calls an innumerable company of people, a great crowd of people who will be in heaven. People from all over the world, from all sorts of backgrounds and cultures, with all sorts of sins and failures. That, of course, is why particularly this prayer is unique. No other person in the entirety of history can do what Jesus does here. In this act of being our substitute, he does the one thing that no one else can. No other perfect, spotless, sinless human being exists who could take our place. We each, if we were in that place, would die for our own sins. If this was you, you would be dying for your own sin. But here, the perfect Son of God, the Lord Jesus, takes our place and bears our wrath. Now, this is a point that's picked up by one of the greatest English thinkers of all time, the theologian John Owen. In his commentary on Hebrews, he wrote a whole series of books on the book of Hebrews. In his commentary on Hebrews, he does a very interesting thing. He takes us to a section of Hebrews where it's describing Jesus as our high priest. So under Old Testament laws, you had a high priest who represented the people and who went in once a year and made this prayer and sacrifice for the people to cover their sin. And Hebrews is talking about that, and here it is in Hebrews 5:7. Jesus, in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, was heard because of his godly fear. The prayer that Jesus offers is a pattern for us because they show Jesus as a human going through what all of us go through, hardship. That hardship leads him to cry out in prayer to the one who is able to save him. That's Hebrews 5. That itself is clear. We've looked at that already in the first point. But the paradox is that the situation that Jesus finds himself in Gethsemane is unique in that he is not only suffering in his praying, but he is offering up a prayer as a high priest and doing something remarkable. What does that mean? Well, I'm fairly convinced that Hebrews 5 is talking about Gethsemane. The prayers that Jesus offers up with loud cries and tears, that's what's in the mind of the writer of Hebrews, Gethsemane. In that letter in Hebrews, he thinks about Christ's work as our high priest. He thinks back to Gethsemane and he sees two things going on there. The two things coming together, Jesus' work as a high priest and his prayers in Gethsemane. And he's saying he's acting there in the prayer as the high priest, offering up what? That's really the key question. What is Jesus offering up here? What is he submitting in? What is he doing? The word of Hebrews 5 is very interesting, the offered up. We use it in English when we talk about offering up a sacrifice. It's the same in the original. He's offering up something in the prayer. Well, of course, he's offering up himself. That's the offering. It suggests that Jesus is praying in Gethsemane, doing the work of high priest, and John Owen says that probably means that he is starting to carry our sins at this point. So after this point, going through all the trials and beatings, and then to the cross, culminating in his death at the cross, he's bearing our sins because he's offered himself in these loud cries and tears. And that's pretty deep stuff. And I have to say, it utterly humbles me. No wonder then that there's sweat, drops of blood going on here. No wonder his body is at the absolute limits. Even just in this prayer, I say just in this prayer. And of course, that very helpfully brings me to the response. How do I respond to such extraordinary things? Well, if I'm not a Christian, the first thing I do is repent of my sin. Because I see somebody here who will carry my sin, who will take my sin as his own and make payment for it and set me free. So if you're not a Christian, that's what you do. That's the first thing you respond, the first way you respond, by repentance. And then trust by saying, Lord Jesus, I'm sorry that I've failed. Please take my sin and forgive me and make me whole and help me to follow you. That's the first response. But then, of course, for those of us who are Christians, that's the ongoing response as well, isn't it? I look at Jesus here in Gethsemane. I hear his prayer. I see the agony. And I repent of my sin and I trust him again today. And I adore, and I worship, and I bow down, and I commit myself to him. So let's sing.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. A sinner condemned, unclean.
let me repeat our thanks to our brother Paul Lintott for bringing God's word to us today, and I trust that it's done you good to hear of our Lord Jesus Christ again from his word. Thank you too for watching wherever you are. I trust that God blesses your week and encourages you through his word and by his Holy Spirit as you live for him. And if you are someone who doesn't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your own friend and saviour, let me encourage you to call out to him and he will hear you. And if you want to know more or need advice or help or want to ask any questions of us as a church, we're available and we're ready to listen, and we want to help as much as we are able. And so there's a few details that will come up at the end of this video of our website, and that will have ways to contact us if you'd like to do that. Let me wish you a blessed week then, and now let's close with these words that many of us know so well. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forevermore. Amen.